Okay, so what are we going to talk about today? Well, the most recent book that came out covering the era we're going to talk about today is called Europe's Apogee. So that should kind of tell you what we're looking forward to. There is a tendency among Europeans to have this very romantic view of European history and how successful European states were in the past. But the 17th century we're going to see is kind of an era of continuous non-stop warfare, easily comparable to conflicts in Africa during the Cold War, easily comparable to the collapse of the Qing Chinese Imperium and the era of warlords, easily comparable to many other places that, according to some Europeans, are problematic. In another name, we're going to see Europe at its worst locally. After that, we'll see it at its worst when it mistreats other people. But if you have the question, where does imperialism come from? The issues of this era can partly explain. Now, one easy way for you to follow this class is in every era to ask the following question. What are the main rivalries? In another name, what are the main competitions and conflicts between important political actors that dominate the politics of the era? And what are the main issues? Countries do not fight each other just because they don't like each other's face. Maybe Greece and Turkey are an exception. They usually fight each other because they got issues. Issues can be territorial issues. I want this plot of land, you want this plot of land, we're not sharing it, so we're gonna fight. They can be political issues. I don't like the way you run your country. I think you should run it the way I say. Or you don't like that, I'll beat you up. There can be religious issues, which tend to be political issues that we're going to learn in this era. I don't like your God. And the way you run your country in the name of your God. I think you should run it the way my God says. There can be even issues about who gets to use a river or who gets to fish in the sea. Now, the era we're going to look at starts in the 1600s, okay? It's the early 17th century. The Renaissance, the era called the Renaissance in Western Europe has come to an end, and the powerful princes that started building their centralized kingdoms in the era of the Renaissance are now competing with each other for control of Europe. And the main rivals are two ancient and great houses. The House of Bourbon that rules France and has just replaced the old Valois dynasty, and the House of the Habsburgs, which rules Austria, essentially what we today call Central Europe, and Spain and its massive empire. In both of the cases, the creators of these dynasties were adventurers, in a way. You all know the story of the prince in the white horse, yeah, right? How the prince on the white horse comes and saves the lady. You all know that image, right? Everybody's waiting for their prince or princess on the white horse. No, the original story starts when Maximilian Habsburg literally rides on a white horse, heading an army of lanzknechts to save the daughter of the dead Duke of Burgundy from the very angry Dutch and Belgian subjects that have rebelled and are besieging her in her house in the capital city. That's where the image comes from. He obviously was not completely pure and full of blood and everything from killing all those burghers, but that's the idea. He saved her from the mob, married her, and gained an empire. The Bourbon king, the original one, is Henri IV, also called the Good Henri in France. And he was essentially a Protestant prince who peace to the country after a very long period of war. But both of them inherit the rivalries of the previous ones. So why are these guys fighting. First of all, they're fighting over Italy. Who is going to control Italy? In this era, Italy is important, not simply because it's very rich by the standards of Europe, but also whoever controls Italy will dominate the Western Mediterranean. They are also fighting over Belgium. Back then it's called Flanders. In this era, Belgium is the richest area in Europe. The cities of Belgium and of the Netherlands are the most powerful economically centers of Europe. Whoever controls it controls the nascent banking system and the early capitalist currency system. So it is a very big fight. At the same time, the Dutch, who have become Protestant, have rebelled against Spanish rule. And this war has been lasting, it's going to last, has already been lasting 50 years, and it's going to last another 30 years. It's called the 80 Years' War. The Dutch, powerful economically, enterprising, and among the protagonists of the nascent slave trade from Africa, have been amassing fortunes and fighting to overthrow their Habsburg Catholic overlords. Now, this is what's going on in Western Europe. At the same time, Eastern Europe is not at peace. There are a number of rivalries that connect with the main Habsburg Bourbon rivalry. The Polish Wasas and Swedish Wasas. Do you know Wasa? You know the crackers? The Wasa crackers? These are literally named from the royal dynasty. It was the royal dynasty of the Wasas. And what happened is, half of the Wasas became Catholic, and they became the elected kings of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The other half became Protestant and became kings of Sweden. And they didn't recognize each other's rule. So they were busy fighting each other over who is going to inherit both kingdoms. At the same time, Sweden is facing the rising might of the Tsardom of Muscovy, of Russia, and they're competing over control of the Baltic. Why the Baltic? Because the Baltic is important, because it's the only way back then that Russia can export its main products to the European economic system. This being wood for ships, extremely important for England. Meanwhile, Russia is also conflicting with the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, a massive state that controls the territories of what is today Poland, Belorussia, parts of Ukraine, and they are conflicting over control of those parts of the country that Orthodox Christians live in, especially the Cossacks. This is a huge conflict over who's going to rule Sweden, Poland, Russia, and over who's going to control the Ukraine and the important transportation network of the Baltic. Finally, in the Eastern Mediterranean, an epic war is going on between the Ottoman Empire and the Republic of Venice over control of the strategically important and extremely rich island of Crete, known in Turkish as Kirit. That's our protagonists. All of these are important, but for this class, the most important rivalry is the Habsburg group. You will see later on why it is. Now, what's the greatest issue at this period? Now, Central Europe, what today is Germany, the Czech Republic, Slovenia, were all part of the same political system. This political system was the Holy Roman Empire of the Germanic nation. And the Holy Roman Empire was really a confederation. It was a weird system in which there was an emperor who was elected, but he had very specific powers. And every prince, city-state that was a member of the empire had their own authority, and sometimes in the same territory, different princes could have authority. So, for example, let's say you were a citizen of the city of Nuremberg, okay? You would obey, obviously, the rules of the city of Nuremberg, but at the same time, you might also be paying taxes to the archbishop, let's say, of Würzburg. And at the same time, the emperor might have legal rights of you, and the prince palatinate might have rights to raise troops in your area. So it was a system where there was no clear overarching authority. Is that there was always a competition on one side between the emperor, who tried to solidify himself as the primarch, as the highest authority in the Holy Roman Empire, and the citizens, the princes, who'd like to keep as much authority as they could to themselves. This conflict is old, goes back to the Middle Ages, but in this era it takes a more intense form because of religion. When Martin Luther hammered this on the cathedral, I think it remember, but I'm not sure, he provided religious justification for the princes of Germany to resist the demands of the emperor that he should have the primacy in power of the Holy Roman Empire. A lot of the princes, especially in northern Germany, became Protestant. And the first thing they did was close the monasteries and take all their money. Always, everywhere, the first thing the Protestant faith does, it essentially nationalizes, puts under the control of the throne, the massive religious wealth of the Catholic faith. The large monasteries with their libraries, with their wine-producing lands and everything, destroying past Catholic Church power within their territory and undermining the emperor, because in this era the administrative apparatus of the state, the bureaucracy in many Catholic countries is one and the same as the Catholic Church. So when you attack the church, you undermine attempts at centralization. Okay? At the same time, the emperor, and this has been passed to the emperor since the 15th century, present themselves as champions of the Catholic Church and use this conflict as a way to demand that the princes submit to the will of the chosen of the Pope and ask the representative of God of heaven. On this topic, we can expect the conflict areas from an empire. So, Kirin is over here, and then is the Venetian Republic essentially. The Ottoman Empire, the Eastern Mediterranean, if Kirin falls, the Ottoman Empire will be able to expand its power to the Western Mediterranean. Italy is divided into many different small states, some of which are supported by Bourbon France, and some of which are supported by the Habsburgs, who control the Kingdom of Spain and its dependencies, including the Kingdom of Naples over here, and the Holy Roman Empire. How do these people try to resolve these issues? There are essentially five tools that are used by them. Okay? In every era, the question is, who are the opponents, what are they competing over, and what are the tools they have available to resolve them? In this era, there are not that many tools. The oldest one is, of course, creating alliances. And alliances take three forms. There can be defensive alliances, where I say, you're Milan, you're going to be attacked by France. I, Austria, will provide you with money and troops and declare war on France. Offensive alliances, in which I say, well, Sweden, if you want to take away parts of Poland, I, Russia, will help you. So we'll attack together. And grouping alliances. Alliances are a special kind of alliance, which is going to play a very big role in the modern history in this class. A grouping alliance is this: I'm afraid of you. I am really terrified of you. You are a threat to me. But I don't feel strong enough to resist you. and I don't have any allies willing to fight with me. One option I have is to ally with you and hope by cooperating with you to control your gains. Another name in a group in alliance, you ally with your threat. Hopefully, turning it towards other easier pickings, and at the same time controlling how much they gain. Now, what's the problem with such an alliance? Does it resolve my security dilemma? Does it resolve the question of your threat to me? Think about what's going on. You are a threat, okay? And I help you beat up the person next door in the hopes that you won't beat me up. What can be the problem with this? Yes? Right? It's like you are still building your friend to become stronger. You just hope that you can gain some strength from that operation, or you hope that you can make this process so slow that in the future maybe you can resolve the problem. It's a risky endeavor, and you're going to say it is not that under international politics. Those are the alliances. Another way is compensation regimes. What do you think this is? What does the idea of compensation create in your mind? What does it mean as a word? What does it mean to say, I compensate? I compensate. When do we compensate somebody? I gain something and you're not happy about it. So in order to win your support for that, I help you gain something. Maybe I give you something from mine, or maybe I help you take somebody's house territory. In compensation regimes, the idea is, if France gains, let's say, territory in Italy, Spain can demand that France either give it some territory in return or help it take territory elsewhere. So, France, I'm going to tolerate you taking Milan, but in return, I want you to help me take Morea from the other. The idea there is that no great power can tolerate any growth of another great power without demanding compensation. And of course, if compensation is not given, that's a problem. Subsidies. One way to help other people without aligning with them, which creates requirements to fight for injuries, you can pay them to do things for you. I am really scared of Spain. But I don't want to fight Spain, and I don't really want to get in a war with Spain. But hey, you know, you the Dutch people, you're making problems for Spain. Here's 50,000 golden marks for you guys to continue creating problems for Spain. States in this era have the tendency of paying other states to maintain their conflicts and thus keep their enemies busy. Of course, this happens today through the proxy wars. But it's much more hardcore back then. Yes? Yeah, it's paying somebody who is threatened by the other side. It's essentially paying somebody else to fight for it. War, of course, we can fight. This is the era when princes prove their honor and their ability. War is considered a completely legitimate way to resolve problems, and indeed, for a new king or a new prince, war is the best way to show that they are serious and worthy of investment. And finally, this very interesting thing called belligerent status. Belligerent status is a weird legal principle in which you can be fighting somebody without being at war. How does this work? Well, essentially, you send your army to fight, but you place that army under the order of another country, and though your army is fighting with this enemy, because they are fighting technically under the order of another country, you are not directly at war, so you can continue trade at the same time. It's a weird system in which we can essentially declare yourself to be a belligerent, but not necessarily be directly in a situation of war. This has legal consequences in this era's legal system, because it permits you to continue doing things like trade and even get taxes. You could be getting taxes from your fiefs in another country while your army is fighting them, because you're just a belligerent, not a war. Consider the rival which we talked about in the previous slides and these systems. What do you think is going to be the primary characteristic of warfare in diplomacy in this era? Do you think conflicts will be able to be kept local? Or will everybody try to use these tools to check their opponent? And essentially, every conflict will become continental in a sense. And do you think those continental conflicts will take the form of World War I? Or perhaps there are going to be weird situations where everybody is going to be fighting wars with each other, but those wars are never going to be considered legally one war. What do you think? You can talk between yourselves. So, are conflicts going to remain localized? Or will they expand across all the rivalry networks? The second thing, will those wars become one big war? Or are you going to have essentially a number of contemporaneous wars going on? Take a minute, talk with each other. Back there as well, talk with each other. Okay, local or expanded? And secondly, one war or multiple wars at the same time? I'm sure you're so hot on this question. Well, there are Catholics and Protestants, obviously that will also play a role. But the question, the 30 years war, we're going to learn about it today, yes. But I want you to think about, like, will you have a 30 years war that everybody is fighting at the same time because there is one war, or are you going to have a weird situation of multiple wars happen at the same time? Yes. Yeah. Exactly. So one idea we have here is that the wars will expire. It will be very hard to localize them. But at the same time, it will be very hard to connect all the wars into one war. Why? Because with systems like belligerent status and subsidies, you don't actually have to participate in another war. You can support those fighting there to keep your opponent. But because of alliances and compensation regimes, the rivalries are all going to be connected. You're going to notice that Europe's history in this era is dominated by usually one major war going on in the center and a number of satellite wars connected with it going on in the rest of Europe, but never completely meshed. Well, the wars are different reasons for everybody, but they get connected from the rivalries. The big reason is because thanks to belligerent status and subsidies, you can essentially get away with war without being part of the war. It's very important. You can fight a war without necessarily having to become part of the war. Now, let's go to the main war here, the 30 years war. Now, what is the cause of this war? Ferdinand II becomes emperor of the Holy Roman Empire in 1618, and he is a really fanatical Catholic. He is hardcore Catholic, and he believes that it is his duty to do away with the half measures that have been dominating Germany ever since the 16th century, and finally resolve the question of Catholicism and Protestantism in Germany decisively, and in a way that raises the importance and power of the imperial throne versus all the other princes of the empire. Okay? That's the general cause. But the immediate cause is very specific. then, the area of the Czech Republic was called Bohemia, and it was a Protestant stronghold due to the Hussite rebellion and heresy in the 15th century. The Czechs were essentially ruled by Protestant aristocracy that did not like the idea of their king, who is Ferdinand II, attempting to restrict the religious rights. Of course, this restriction of religious rights had everything to do also with economic power, because guess what? Whenever an area became Protestant and took all that money away from the church, where do you think that money went? Who do you think gained? All that massive money and power that used to be within the Catholic Church, all those lands, the monasteries had huge lands. Who do you think gets that? The prince or the king or his aristocratic followers? It was also a question of money and religion, all of it together. So when he becomes Holy Roman Emperor, he tries to do the classical thing of every Habsburg goes to Bohemia and says, confirm me as your king. You see, the Bohemian throne is an elected throne. It means the king is elected by the aristocracy, just like the Polish throne and just like the Swedish throne. And the Bohemians say, no. Instead, they elect as their king this guy, Frederick the Fifth, Elector Palatine, who is one of the protagonists of Protestantism in Germany. And they divorce the Habsburg dynasty. So what? Why would this be important? The Habsburgs control so many other lands in Germany. They have Austria, they have part of Hungary, they control, they have a large control of Milan, they have lands in the north. Who cares if they lost the royal title of Bohemia? Here's why it's important. The emperor is voted by electors, and there are, if I remember correctly, in this era, either 6 or 9 electors. One of those electoral positions is the Kingdom of Bohemia. In another name, losing Bohemia cost the Habsburgs one of the votes that assured them winning the imperial elections and keeping control of the Holy Roman Empire. Also, Bohemia is rich. It's a very populous and important part of the Holy Roman Empire. Losing this means that the Habsburgs lose the linchpin, the center of their power in Germany. They lose an electoral vote, they lose prestige, they lose a royal title. There are only 3 royal titles in the Holy Roman Empire. There is the title of King of the Germans, King of Rome, the King of Bohemia. If they lose that, and the title of King of Rome and King of Germans always goes to whoever is elected as emperor. They lose the Kingdom of Bohemia, they're just encroached. So they cannot let Bohemia. So what happens is Ferdinand II uses the Catholic cause to raise an army out of his fellow Catholic princes and crush the Bohemians at the Battle of White Mountain. This is a massive victory, and what follows is the extermination, physical and political, of the Bohemian aristocracy. Bohemia ceases being a Protestant left. He replaces them with Catholics. Now, you are one of the other German princes who are Protestant. Palatinate, Saxony, Hessen. And you see this happen, okay? You just saw one of the most combative, strong Protestant aristocracies of the Holy Roman Empire get completely annihilated and replaced. Lose everything. How do you feel? You feel secure? Do you worry that you might be next? So what do you do then? princes go to war with the emperor. And guess what? They get money and political support from the Ottoman Empire for this war. Why would the Ottoman Empire support the Protestant princes against the Holy Roman Emperor? They do want to do that exactly. Also, specifically, the Holy Roman Emperor is supporting Venice in its conflict with the Ottomans. You see how the rivalries start becoming connected. So, in order to make their victory over Venice easier, the Ottomans support a major Protestant rebellion in Germany. Now, at the same time, the Emperor asks for help from his cousin, the King of Spain, Philip III, who is one of the most powerful Catholic monarchs in Europe, and from the Polish-Lithuanian kingdom, which is also Catholic controlled. Princess, versus the Emperor. Yeah, because the Emperor was supporting Venice against the Ottoman Empire. Okay? Also, there was a competition between the Habsburgs and the Ottomans for control of Hungary. Remember, in this era, the Ottoman Empire's borders reached the Danube, and Hungary is essentially a contest between the two realms. Interestingly, in Hungary, the Ottomans support Protestant princes and aristocrats, while the Habsburgs support Catholic ones. So essentially, wherever the Ottomans find Eastern Protestants, they support them. Now, this is a picture of the Battle of White Mountain. Now, here's what happens. Because of those conflicts, Poland declares war, enters a war with the Ottoman Empire. So essentially, the cross support leads to a war between Poland and the Ottoman Empire, and at the same time, the Dutch, in order to weaken the Catholics in Europe, also support the Protestant princes, who obviously leads to the Spanish re-intervening and attacking the Dutch. So essentially, what starts as a local conflict between the Bohemian aristocracy and their king expands into a series of interconnected wars in Central and Eastern Europe. England entered this. You know, until now, I haven't really talked that much about England. And we already said that the great rival of the Habsburg dynasty are the Bourbons of France, but they haven't entered yet. That back then, there are colonies, they have started the colonial project, but it's actually a very small part of the European empires. In this year, the Europeans can't really defeat other polities easily. So most of the colonial empires are essentially small trade outposts that coordinate with local powerful lords. France, there's a civil war going on. France has its own Protestants. Indeed, there are not few. Back then, there are about 10% to 20% of the population, and they're mostly city people, so they are rich, the Huguenots. And the Huguenots are in conflict with the Catholic kings, and at the same time, the Catholic kings have to face their own Catholic aristocrats. So the French king is busy, on the one hand, trying to force the Protestants of France to obey, and on the other hand, trying to survive the attempts of the French aristocracy to keep its ancient rights. In England, Parliament and the king have very serious issues. And there is also a war going on in Ireland. Indeed, between 1627 and 1629, the Duke of Buckingham, who is the king's favorite, leads England into war with France because the English are supporting the Huguenots. Have any of you seen the Three Musketeers or read the Three Musketeers by Alexandre Dumas? Do you remember the Duke of Buckingham there? He was the guy who sent the necklace to the queen. The Three Musketeers is all about this era, okay? So, the French are busy, the Dutch are busy, the Protestant princes get their ass kicked by the Catholic, and the Bohemians are crushed. So do the Habsburg win. No. Enter Armand Jean de Blessé, Cardinal Duke de Richelieu. Okay? Again, those of you who have read The Three Musketeers know who I'm talking about. I'll give you a break once we move a bit. Richelieu is essentially the Prime Minister of France. He's also a cardinal of the Catholic Church. Back then, that was very usual. Remember what I told you in Catholic countries, that bureaucracy and the church usually go together. We're going to meet later on another important cardinal, a cardinal Infante, who is actually a general. So you have this warlord who is essentially a cardinal of the Catholic Church. But Richelieu is essentially a very important person in this era because he is the first legitimate authority that promotes a kind of way of thinking about politics that is not new, but before had mostly been talked about by people like Machiavelli. Nobody respected Machiavelli by the 17th century. They considered him an eccentric Republican. Okay? The prince was officially, if you read Machiavelli's The Prince, was officially prohibited. It was proscribed by the Catholic Church. If you read it, your soul went to hell. Which is probably where Machiavelli's soul was, according to the Catholic Church. So, these are not new ideas, but they were not ideas that proper people, polite society, we talk about. Not Richelieu made a very strong argument. France's security, the security of the Kingdom of France, cannot rest on the goodwill of foreign powers. According to Catholic doctrine, all of the Catholic kings are brothers in an amiable family. And you can feel secure. It's okay if your brother is like a massive empire, you're a tiny country, they're brothers. Your brother is never going to hurt you. You tell yourselves this is complete hogwash. This is a propaganda by the Habsburgs. France cannot survive on the goodwill of foreign powers. France can only rely for its security on its own strength. And that strength can only be built by the King of France within his country having absolute power. No special rights to minorities, no special rights to aristocrats. No private armies, only one army in France, the army of the King of France. No rights of the Catholic Church or the Pope to interfere in the politics of France. And secondly, that France must be secure from foreign threats. Indeed, Richelieu, if God himself or itself or herself threatens France, then God must be defeated. Okay? Something like this. Sorry for the small video screen. Work. You're fine because you want to go to the chair afterwards. And after that, give you a break. Don't worry.
What are the most surprised? Okay, how does this guy come up with this idea? Okay, Machiavelli was a weirdo who read too much about Romans. He was a nerd. Ubergeek. A hero geek. Okay? So, okay. Machiavelli wants to recreate the Roman Republic and really hates barbarians, by which he means the Spanish, the Germans, and the French, because for an Italian of the Renaissance, those are the barbarians. Okay? But what about him? He's French. He's a barbarian. Now, France, between 1562 and 1598, was what we would call today a failed state. Take Syria, put it the size of France, and you got France in that era. There was a massive civil war going on. On the one side, you had French magnates, powerful French Catholic nobles trying to become more powerful and essentially make the king of France as weak as the king of Poland. Then you had the Huguenots trying to protect their faith and also expand it. Let us all become Calvinists. The Huguenots are really hardcore Protestants. They're not some pathetic Lutheran half-bakes. They're Calvinists. They're like, we're going to burn the witches. Okay? Then you have the king, or multiple kings, trying to keep the throne and grow their strength. So all of these people are fighting each other, and guess what? The Spanish and the English are continuously intervening. They're sending money to the various sites. They're throwing armies into the various sites. So in this era, France is a helper. You all know the Knight of St. Bartholomew. Have you ever heard of that term? The Knight of St. Bartholomew. What happened is, in order to stop the war, there was an agreement to marry the most important Protestant prince of France, Henri IV, before he became king, with Margot, the sister of the then king of France. And what happens, all of the Protestant high aristocrats come to Paris to take part in the wedding. It's a royal wedding. The guest list runs in the tens of thousands. Something like 5,000 or 6,000 Protestants come from their cities into Paris as guests of the king for the marriage. But what happens is the French magnates, the Guises, who do not want peace to happen in France, organize a massacre together with the mother of the king. And something like 1,000 or 2,000 Protestants are killed in their beds by the Parisian mob. Yes, it was kind of like, that's where the Red Wedding comes from, okay? Think of the Red Wedding only on a huge scale. And of course, it leads to a war. So this is France in this era. And this is 30 years of history. This is not just like 5 years or 10 years. This is a massive amount of history. Richelieu grows up in this era. Richelieu is determined about one thing. I will never see France go through this again. Which means all of those who are responsible for bringing France close to destruction will pay the price. French magnates will learn to obey the king. They will give up their political and military power. French Huguenots. Richelieu is a tolerant man. I don't care which god or how you believe in your god. But you will have no castles, you will have no forts, you will not have your own artillery, you will not have your own guns, and you will definitely not make alliances with foreign kings. Finally, like the English are busy killing each other. Really? The magnates, he denies them their castles, he orders the castles to be demolished. Those who resist, like Henry II, the Montmorency, are destroyed on the battlefield. But who gets? You can have your God, your churches, but no political lives, definitely no weapons. Those who submit are permitted to continue. Those who resist, like the city of La Rochelle, are besieged throughout this era. That takes care of the eternal threat. And what is the greatest? Oh, wow, around, fix it, and you see it. They take a 20-minute break. Now, in the previous part of the class, we talked about the 30-year old cancer battle. We were specifically talking about Richelieu and his policy for France. And we said that domestically, he's trying to gain security for France. How is he trying to get security for France domestically? Who is he trying to defeat? Is he trying to defeat Coca-Cola? Disney? Paris Disney? Enemy? Who are his opponents to his goal of securing France domestically? Magnates? Yes, aristocrats? And? Yes. How are they called? The Who? Are they called the Who? Yeah, that band is definitely a bunch of Protestants there they were. The Huguenots. Yeah, exactly. The Huguenots are the Protestants of France. So what is he trying to do to these people, the magnates, the aristocrats, and the Huguenots? What is Richelieu trying to do? What's his problem with them? Okay, economic influence, too much power, but mostly their military power. Also, they cooperate with foreign powers. Now, of those foreign powers, the greatest threat for Richelieu is the Habsburgs. Wow, look at this map, which we couldn't see before. Now, in orange are the areas of Europe that are ruled by either the Spanish or the Austrian Habsburgs. France is located here. What do you notice? Exactly, they're surrounded by Habsburgs. Now, the Netherlands over here is rebellion, but the southern part are still controlled by the Habsburgs. Now, what will happen if the Holy Roman Empire Habsburg was able to change the constitution of the Holy Roman Empire from a confederation of loosely associated princes into, let's say, a federation where the center has the most important power, kind of like the United States of America. What color would all of this become? Orange. And what does that mean for France? Yes, France is completely encircled. Of course, the Habsburgs tell the French, We're Catholic. We're brothers. You don't have to worry about surrounding you. We are going to keep security for you. Now, Richelieu doesn't believe that. Indeed, Richelieu is fighting Catholics in his own country, the Magnates. What would happen if those magnates decided to ask for help from his most Catholic majesties, the emperor and the Spanish king? Yes, exactly. If the emperor dominates the Holy Roman Empire, the power of the Habsburgs is so vast that there is no possibility for the Bourbon dynasty to stay on the French throne. They're going to be overthrown, as they were almost overthrown during the French Revolution, were replaced by the De Guise or who knows what. Oh, what does this mean for Richelieu? What must he stop at all costs? Well, there are no English Catholics here. Don't worry about that. He must make sure this doesn't change color. He must make sure that France does not become encircled by the Spanish dominance. So he has to make sure the war in Germany continues, that the emperor does not win. Now, here's the problem. Because Richelieu is busy imposing absolute power within France, he cannot afford to go to war with Spain and the throne of an emperor. He can't. So what does he do? Together with Charles I, the King of England, they give money and support diplomatically an intervention into the war by the King of Denmark. Denmark is an independent kingdom. At the same time, the King of Denmark is also the Duke of Schleswig-Holstein, and thus one of the princes of the Holy Roman Empire, but most importantly, the King of Denmark is a Protestant. So with economic support from France and England, he raises an army and he enters into the 30 Years' War against the Emperor, enacting the Danish phase of the 30 Years' War. The first phase of the war from 1618 to 1625 is called the Bohemian phase, or the German phase. It's mostly Germans versus Germans. But with this phase, you have a non-German ruler, the Danish king, intervening. Denmark, supported financially by France and England, and in alliance with the Dutch Republic, fights against the Spanish and Austrian Habsburgs, who are supported by Bavaria, which is an extremely important, powerful Catholic principality. The Danish intervention is led by King Christian IV of Denmark, and he faces two opponents, Count Johannes Tilly, known as Father Tilly by his troops, who is the generalissimo, essentially the warlord, who commands the armies of the Catholic League, which is an alliance between various Catholic princes in Germany, with Bavaria being the most important, who support the emperor. And the emperor himself has his own army, which is paid by Spain, by the way, which is led by Albert von Wallenstein, a powerful Protestant Catholic Czech noble. Christian is decisively defeated in battle and forced to give up in 1629. And this is the high point of Habsburg power. With the defeat of the Danish king, a lot of the German Protestant princes have no choice but to bend the knee, as they say in Game of Thrones, and make some kind of peace with the emperor. The emperor shows clearly what his goal is. In 1629, he declares the Edict of Restitution. Under this edict, all of the land and money and buildings taken from the Catholic Church by the Protestant nobles of Germany are to be returned to the Catholic Church. That means all the economic power gained by the reforming princes is going to be denied to them. Over here, this is from one of his wars with Sweden. There is Father Tilly, Papa Tilly, as he was called, because he was very good in his soldiers. Now, in reaction to this, Richelieu has to act. His plan, his master plan, to use the Danes to stop the Catholics in Germany, fails. So he has to figure out another way. The first thing he does is this. Now here's the thing. The armies of the Spanish Habsburgs are located mostly in Spain and Naples. This is where their effective regiments are arrayed. Now, they cannot go this way because of the Dutch Navy. So what they do instead is they march all the way along an area of Europe called the Spanish Road. Essentially, they congregate on the Dukedom of Milan, controlled by the Habsburgs. Then they cross through the Switzerland into Franconia, an area that is controlled by pro-Habsburg princes. And then they march all the way north to reach Flanders to fight the Dutch. This is called the Spanish Road. So Richelieu makes a decisive move. He fosters a war in northern Italy called the War of Mantua Succession. Mantua was a small principality, in order to block the road. So there's a war going on between Venice, France, Milan, and Mantua and local lords over here, and this essentially cuts the road off. Okay? Which means that Spanish armies and Spanish gold cannot reach the German theater of the war. Okay? That's how he tries to cut
the amount of support that the Spanish Habsburgs can give to their cousin. Obviously, as you can see, this also creates a new war in Europe. So you see how the wars essentially continue, adding and adding and adding. But that's not enough. That takes care of Spain, but it doesn't care take care of the power of the emperor within Germany. Doesn't care take care of the League, the Catholic Army, League Army under Tilly. Doesn't take care of the Imperial Army under Palestine. He needs an army. France cannot offer that army. He's busy beating up the Huguenots and the Mandans within France. Denmark lost. England is busy with itself. Where do you find an army? Turns out there is another Protestant king out there who just happens to have an army ready. And that is the king of Sweden, Gustavus Adolphus. You see, from 1600 to 1629, thanks to Habsburg diplomacy, Sweden is busy fighting the Polish, the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, okay? So as a result, Gustavus Adolphus, who is a pretty hardcore Protestant, as fanatically Protestant as the emperor is Catholic, cannot intervene in the whole in the 30 Years' War. He's busy fighting the Poles. Well, in 1629, there is a peace between the Polish Lithuanian capital that has run out of money and Sweden. Okay? As a result of this peace, Gustavus Adolphus has a battle-hardened army, which uses innovative tactics it has learned and honed in its warfare with the Polish. And that army can be used. He's a religious fanatic. He sees himself literally as the lion of Protestantism, the protector of the faith, and the enemy of the Antichrist, which is the Pope. This is literally the propaganda. I can show you, if you look at the Google propaganda pamphlets, this is literally the propaganda. The Pope is the Antichrist, the devil. Okay? He can gain money and political gains. Money, well, the French are going to pay for this army in English. He's not going to pay for it. He doesn't have any money. Sweden is poor. He has an army. But if he wins freedom of Protestants in Germany, of course, Sweden will gain some things like commercial rights, commercial interest, and especially control of the Baltic, which is extremely important. Whoever controls the Baltic controls all the trade between Flanders, England, and Russia and Poland, especially the massive timber trade from Russia. And finally, he hates the Habsburgs because the bloody Habsburgs supported the Poles against him. This is why this war lasted 29 years. Habsburg money and Habsburg diplomatic support of the Poles. So now is the time for the line of the door to get even with it. So with French and Dutch financial banking, massive loans, his ally, the Elector of Saxony, wins a number of massive great victories against the Emperor between 1630 and 1632. Tilly literally dies in one of the battles. Okay? At the same time, when the Poles start talking about, well, Sweden, you know that peace between 1629? You don't feel okay about this, okay? So we think we're going to start the war again. Richelieu, Armand versus, goes to the Ottomans and says, hey Sultan, you know, France, the Ottoman Empire, we're brothers, right? Can you attack the Poles while our Swedish bro is beating the crap out of the Catholics? And here's some money, by the way, to fund your little war. And the Pope of the Dynasty says, yeah, why not? So at the same time, the Pope of the Dynasty also gives some money to the Russian Tsar. So in order to make sure the Poles cannot interfere and stop Sweden from intervening in Germany, then the Ottomans and the Russians attack Poland. So you see how the wars are ongoing, how everybody uses a local war in one era area to block intervention in another war in another era. This is Richelieu's diplomacy that succeeds in this. Okay? So we have an idea about how hardcore Gustavus Adolphus is. Here is Salvatore with Lion on the door.
thing is, this is the kind of enthusiasm he actually produced in the era. I'm not making this up. Like, they didn't listen to Kevin Middlebach, but the pamphlets, the Protestant fathers, literally produced these guys, the coming of God on earth, the crash of the evil of the Pope. They were really enthusiastic about it. After 29 years, after 10 years of getting their ass kicked by Tilly and Wallace, the Protestants finally get a champion. Okay? However, in 1632, in the Battle of Lützen, Gustavus Adolphus is riding forward with his horn and gets isolated inside a squadron of Catholic cavalry, who then go up and shoot him dead. Gustavus Adolphus wins the battles, but the king dies. He had a small wound from his Polish horse, which meant that it was extremely uncomfortable for him to wear the armor that would have protected his life. So he was going into the battle without any armor. So the valet went in and killed him. You can actually see the clothes he was wearing if you go to Stockholm at the Royal Armory. As a result of this, in 1634-35, the Imperials, especially with the help of the Cardinal Infante, the most important Spanish noble and cousin or brother of the King of Spain, I don't remember right now, win a big number of victories and break the power of Sweden in South and Central Germany. Okay? As a result, 1635, once more, the Protestant princes come hat in hand to bend the knee to the Holy Roman Emperor. This time, the emperor doesn't just do the Edict of Restitution. No. The Peace of Prague, which is signed at the capital of the Kingdom of Bohemia, essentially gives the emperor the primacy he wanted. The Holy Roman Empire, from a confederation, becomes a federal state. The princes still exist, they have some rights, but the emperor now a central authority. He becomes the high authority, the high judicial and military authority for the whole of the Holy Roman Empire. Now, place yourself. And this is the title of the year. Place yourselves in the foot, in the boots of Kaladusha. To try and paint Protestant Germans to fight the Habsburgs. Trying to pay Danish Protestants to fight the Habsburgs, they lose. You try to pay Swedish Protestants to fight the Habsburgs, they lose. The great plan of stopping the dominance of the Habsburg dynasty in Europe is dying. What choice is the cardinal having? There is no other army left to fight except for one. Army of France. Thus, 1635, in reaction to the Treaty of Prague, the Kingdom of France declares war on the Spanish and later Austrian Habsburg. This leads to the final phase of the 30 Years' War. Until now, we have seen three phases: the Bohemian or German phase, the Danish phase, the Swedish phase, and this is the final phase, which is called the French phase, in which France directly intervenes in the war with its own army. The next 13 years we'll see a seesaw conflict which no one will clearly win. Sometimes the Imperials will win, sometimes the French will win. What is the result is that Germany, northern Germany, is completely devastated. All of this comes to an end in 1643. When in a village close to the Spanish French border, Rocroix, the last of the old veteran tertios of the Spanish army are destroyed by the Duke of the Prince of Conte, bringing an end to the old Spanish veteran army and the Spanish strength.
another factor. And there was called the push of times for one war. Literally can't see in front of you, and everybody's pushing behind you because they can't see what's going in front of them. So a lot of men will die from asphyxiation. They will essentially not be able to breathe, because think about 10,000 men all pushing each other close to each other. Very nice. This has been going on since 1618. 30 years of war. Okay? After 30 years of war, the Austrian Habsburgs and the Protestant princes who have been fighting for that law are exhausted. They're out of money, they're out of men. Essentially, the only way a farmer can survive is by becoming a soldier, so he can steal food from other farmers. This is how bad the situation is. There is widespread famine in northern Germany. People are dying in massive numbers from the plague and from other infectious diseases. The economy has come to a standstill. Sweden has been fighting for 18 years. Sweden is not a huge country. It's a tiny country in this year, population-wise, and its economy has started to collapse, and demographics are dangerous. Secondly, the people who drove the war passed away. 1637, Ferdinand II dies. His successor, Ferdinand III, wants peace. He is not as religiously fanatical as his brother. He is not willing to break the empire in order to remodel it. Richelieu dies in 1642, and as a result of his death, France enters into a period of political instability called the Fronde, when the various aristocrats that have been crushed by Richelieu take advantage of his death to rebel and try to take control of the throne again. Finally, Spain, the great power of the era, after essentially 30 years of war with the empire, 80 years of war with the Dutch, is collapsing economically. Portugal and Catalonia are involved. And in order to assure the unity of the Spanish Habsburg realm, slowly, slowly, the Spanish armies that have been fighting in Germany are pulled out to be brought back to fight in Spain. For these three reasons, the emperor, the Protestant princes, and Sweden, and Denmark, and France make peace. And this peace, and the demonstration, that you can find on the internet that were created by eyewitnesses, and that will give you an idea of how terrible the conditions were in Germany, in northern Germany. This is called the Peace of Westphalia. It is negotiated starting in 1646 and it's concluded in 1648. It takes 2 years, as a matter of fact, to reach it. And it makes four important points. I mean, there are a lot of points in it. Articles, you can go and read it yourself online if you really want to. Hey, if you can read it in the original German or Latin, bravo, you could. But the main articles that we care about is, number one, the imperial princes have full freedom of religion. In another name, they have the absolute power to decide what kind of religion Catholic or Protestant is going to exist within their domains. And the emperor has no right to interfere. Article 2 that a lot of people forget, the Treaty of Westphalia is the first international treaty that creates, outside of the Islamic context with its dhikmi concept, that creates a right for minorities. Religious minorities within those domains are given some protections to practice the religion. Three, this is the most important. Practice of multiple sovereignty in the border of an empire, where at the same time, in one place, multiple different authorities had rights, the Prince of Würzburg, as we said, the Cardinal, the Emperor, and from now on,
prince of a land is the supreme authority of that land. And no one, including the emperor, can intervene in it. The era where if you were a burgher in Nuremberg, you might have responsibilities to the canton of Würzburg, to the city of Nuremberg, to the prince of Franconia, is over. Now, because Nuremberg is a free city, only the city of Nuremberg has authority on Nuremberg. Now, only the elector of Bavaria has authority in Bavaria. Only the king of Bohemia has authority in Bohemia. The Holy Roman Empire is finalized as a confederation of sovereign princes loosely associated and presided over by an emperor. So when I use the term emperor here, don't think of emperor as the Byzantine or Roman or even Ottoman character. Think of the emperor more like the director of the European Commission, like Juncker. Or think of him as president of the European Union, Laplace. A bit more powerful, but not that much. Finally, the Dutch Republic becomes independent from Spain. The 80 years' war is over. The Spanish Habsburgs give up all of their rights for their life. Peace, finally, Europe! Can we all become brothers and sisters again? Nah. You see, the French are not ready to make peace with the Spanish Habsburgs. So the Spanish-French War will continue up to 1659. The French try to get the Portuguese to become independent, and they succeed. Portugal becomes again an independent kingdom. They also try to get Catalonia to become independent, but they fail. Venetians and the Ottomans are fighting the great war in Crete that is going to last 44 years, not 24 years, and includes the largest and longest siege in the history of the human race, the siege of Handaka, if I remember correctly. And finally, in England, the Protestants are fighting each other. The intervention by the King of England, by Charles I, in the 30 Years' War, created economic issues that lead to a final conflict with his parliament. And this leads to the War of the Three Kingdoms, in which Scotland, Ireland, and England become divided in a conflict between parliamentarians and royalists. The end result is the defeat of the king, who loses his head. And this is the first time that we have a king in Europe being executed for treason by his parliament. Louis XIV is not the first king executed by the people. Charles I is the first king in Europe executed by the people, or those who claim to represent the people. And the creation of the only time in its history where England is not a kingdom, it is actually a republic called the Commonwealth, ruled over by a Lord Protector called Oliver Cromwell. Okay, so we end with 1648, let me see the time. Okay, we end with 1648. I'll give you another break, but we have to cover stuff. And it seems like there's stability in Europe. The main issue of the era, the constitution of the Holy Roman Empire, has finally been resolved. Holy Roman Empire is not a confederation. It will never become a federation. The emperor will never become the central authority. Some issues very important still between the Austrian Habsburgs and the Bourbons, Belgium and Italy. The Netherlands became independent, but Belgium, Flanders, is still under the Habsburg. In Italy, there is still conflict over control of Milan and northern Italy. The newly independent Dutch Republic and the Commonwealth and later English Kingdom begin a number of commercial wars for control of the global trade. They are beginning a number of wars that are the massive naval battles between navies numbering the hundreds of ships, where the Dutch essentially try to defend their maritime Byzantine Empire control of the world trade from the British, who are now demanding that they will control. At the same time, the Dutch and the English, despite being enemies, have a problem with the French, which is they don't want the French to gain control of Belgium. Spain has now become a weak country. It's not scary. On the other hand, France, after all the hard work of Western Europe, seems to be a very powerful country. It is scary. They will prefer Spain to control Belgium and not France, which of course comes to conflict with that. And finally, Sweden comes out of this war as a great power with immense commercial gains in Germany, territorial gains, as well as territorial gains in the Baltic, which obviously creates a reaction by Poland and Lithuania. And everyone else, and when I mean literally everyone else, you will later on see everybody else in Eastern Europe. And the conflict is always over the control of the Baltic. And who will become king of Poland? King of Sweden. All of these fires issues. Okay, and our rivals are still the same. This main rival is still Bourbon versus Habsburg. But now, as you can see, the English and the Dutch become important in the story. Comes to a head because the Spanish throne passes on to Charles II. There is a problem with Charles II. According to accounts, Charles II's jaw was so large that he had difficulty chewing, and his tongue was so large and thick that it was difficult to understand where he spoke. But this was not all. Charles was also epileptic and physically deformed. And shall we say, slow. He did not learn to speak until the age of 4, and he did not walk until he was almost 8. The novices have studied his ancestors and concluded that almost 25% of his genes were homozygous, about the amount that would be expected from the marriage of a brother and a sister. What's going on here? The Spanish Habsburgs were very particular about who keeping their line pure. Unlike all the other dynasties of Europe that married into each other and married with each other, they tended to marry their cousins. And not their sixth degree cousin, but their fourth, third, sometimes second degree cousins. As you know, when you have intermarriage in a family, genetic degeneration. And this is about 100 years of continuous intermarriage. And the end result is this young man. It's not a bad person, but no one expects him to survive. There's no chance of him having children. He tried, but it was impossible. So this raises a question. Charles II dies. Who will become king of Spain? Who will inherit the massive Spanish Habsburg kingdom? Here is Europe after the end of 1648. Over here we have a major battle between Poland and Russia, over the Cossacks, and between Poland and Sweden, over Northern Europe and the Baltic. South America, except for Brazil, is a Spanish imperial colony. It's a possession. Enter Louis XIV. Just like Richelieu grows up in an era of French weakness. Remember what I told you when Richelieu died, French politics entered a period of civil war. Wrong. Louis was an influence. He was essentially hidden away by his mother or protectors in order to avoid the aristocrats that were trying to capture, kidnap him, and control the problem. So, like Richelieu, he comes out and has a view that France must not return back to the bad days. And like Michelin, for him, the solution is within France, absolutism. Once more, the king must become the absolute ruler. Europe, France needs natural borders. What does that mean? It means borders that are protected by big physical characteristics, like huge mountains or big rivers that are not easy for them. He feels that the current French borders are weak, that it's easy for foreign armies or their supporters to enter France and attack him. So he needs borders that are defensive. And finally, Spanish patrimony must not go to the Habsburgs. France must not be. Western Europe, he wants the French border to become the Rhine River. You know, the Rhine River is a big river. It's not easy to cross it. France's border when he becomes king is over here, okay? He would like all of this to become part of France. These are the natural borders of France, which means eating up all of Flanders belonging to the Spanish Habsburgs, parts of the Netherlands, and all of these parts of Germany, the Palatinate and the Rhine, plus the Lorraine, which is in the middle of France and is indebted because it belongs to the Dukes of Lorraine, who are related to the Habsburg Empire. So, the only way you get this is by war. Louis believes in propaganda. He has a certain image of himself, and he uses the new arts, theater, opera, music, to sell that image to the world. You are not a human being. So you give yourself up all the time. Is this him as a young man? Ladies, you hate high heels. This is the guy you should hate. Louis the 14th introduced the high heel as a fashion. Men gave it up at some point, but unfortunately, women were forced to keep it for the rest of history. He was also a ballet dancer and actually very good at it, because all of these things, grace and power, were all parts of the propaganda of a king that was not simply a king, but the very symbolism of God on earth, a son on initially, everything goes well for Louis XIV. Remember that the English have a problem with the Netherlands, which is about trade. So initially, the English are willing to work with Louis XIV against the Dutch, because they're also fighting. So, take the advantage of the Anglo-Dutch wars over trade, he gets the support of England to expand his territory against the Spanish. The Dutch and English fight three wars, of which the first one is won by the English, and when they get a king, they lose all the rest of them. So obviously, having a king is not a good thing for the English. At the same time, France attacks Spain and Belgium, and essentially this is not really so much a war as France going in and slapping around the Spanish because they're so wicked, and then I'm taking this, and I'm taking that. What are you going to do about it, Spain? You can do it. You have a Habsburg leap. I apologize, I was very, very considerate, but that's where it comes from. Then, in 1672, he allies with England and fights the Dutch, and he has to send the Spanish. How has history changed? The Spanish are actually allied with the Dutch, fighting the French and the English. This was not very well for Louis. He gains glory, he gains land, but he doesn't get that natural power. Meanwhile, in the East, France's star is great because its allies are kicking ass. Poland, a historical ally of the Habsburg dynasty, remember, is almost annihilated by Sweden and Russia, Sweden being an ally of France. The Russo-Polish War, 1654-1667, and the Swedish-Polish War, plus Denmark, Brandenburg, Prussia, after that, it's a big war, it's called the First Great Northern War, is so catastrophic for Habsburg interests that during the period, at some point, Russia, which is fighting Poland, also goes to war against Sweden at the same time. So at the same time, Russia is beating up the Poles, who are being beaten up by also Sweden, and also patching Sweden. So it's kind of like a three-way fight. Actually, this is a very dark period of Polish history. It is actually called in Polish history as the Deluge. And I want to be very clear, the Swedes destroy Poland. Something like 40% of all cities and villages in Poland are burned to the ground by the Swedes, okay? 40%. The Polish Royal Archives, the historical archives of the state of Poland, they're not in Poland. The Swedes literally steal them together with hundreds of thousands of books from Poland and put them in Sweden. The great Swedish universities of Uppsala and Stockholm, they are all created essentially by that wealth, money wealth and educational wealth that is literally grabbed and pulled out of Poland. I heard a joke when I was in Sweden that sometimes the Polish state goes and asks, can we have our state archives back? And the Swedes go like, well, you know, we don't really know where they are. And then you can go into Uppsala University and actually check them out. And we're talking about a lot of destruction. This is a very catastrophic and traumatic period for Polish history. Do you know the book Quo Vadis? No, you guys do not read classical literature. I feel like an old man here. Anyway, Nobel Prize winning author, he also wrote a trilogy about the Deluge. So you can read that to learn more about it. This is awesome. In the East, the allies of the Habsburgs are losing. In the West, Louis and his chum, Charles II, King of England, are beating the crap out of the filthy Dutch and the Spanish and Spain. Unfortunately, history has no mercy. Charles II, King of England, who really hates the Dutch, dies. And he is replaced by his brothers, James II. James has a small problem for being King of England. He's Catholic. Now, initially, Charles forces a kind of compromise in which James will become king of England and Scotland and Ireland, but he won't change the religion or anything. But that would have been okay if James was an enemy of Louis, okay? But unfortunately, James is an ally of Louis, and the British Protestants, which is the majority of the population, except from Ireland, are worried about using French money and power. James is going to overthrow the parliamentary regime, give freedom and equality to Catholics, especially Irish Catholics. They're all racists. They hate the Irish. And undermine Britain's peculiar institutions. So, what happens is this. With Dutch military support, Parliament overthrows James II in a violent coup called the Glorious Revolution. And ever since then in history, you have all the Whigs and classical liberals and conservatives in America say, and even, our revolution is better than the French Revolution. Nobody died in our revolution. That is why it was glorious, which is a bloody lie, because there was a massive war in Ireland over this. Okay? And replace James II with William III, who is a Dutch. He's married to Queen Mary, who is the sister of James. But step back for a moment. British Parliament helps a foreign army invade Britain. This is the second only successful historical invasion of Britain after the Norman Conquest, to overthrow the British king and replace him by a Dutch king. Now, if you're Louis XIV, what does that mean? England, your ally, is now ruled by a bloody Dutch person. Not just any Dutch person, William III, your personal nemesis, the man behind all fanatical opposition to your attempts to just get your natural borders. As a result, we enter the period of the Great Wars of Louis XIV, or as I call it, Louis XIV versus the world. He attacks Spain over Belgium again in 1683 and X-1684. When he attempts to cross the Rhine, a grand alliance is formed. But the Spanish and Austrian Habsburg, England, the Dutch, Sweden, and Sapporo versus France and the Irish, who are resisting against the Dutch and are still supporting the Jacobites, James. Okay, this is called the War of the Grand Alliance. This doesn't go well for him. He gets defeated in a number of battles, and like Michelet, he tries to compensate by getting his opponents to focus elsewhere. So like any good French king, he falls back to his traditional ally, the Sultan Padishah of the Ottoman Empire. And in 1683, with French economic support, the Hoplite dynasty launches the Great Turkish War, the Türkenkrieg, in which the Ottoman Empire makes a serious effort to force the Austrian Emperor, the Habsburg Emperor, to lose all of Hungary, and leads to the Second Great Siege of Vienna. And in this war, it's the Ottoman Empire by itself again versus Austrian Habsburgs, Holland, Venice, Russia, and Spain. So at the same time in Europe, in Western Europe, you have the Great, the War of the Great Alliance, and in Eastern Europe, you have the Great Turkish War. Both wars end badly for me. In the East, at Vienna, the Polish, together with the Imperials, charge and destroy the massive besieging army, leading even to the death of the Grand Vizier, Mehmed Koprulu. The followers in Hungary under the command of commanders like Eugene of Savoy leads to decisive
innocent or the lawgiver is lost to the other. In the West, he is unable to win it with the dignity of history. He has to accept a border that is not on the right. Okay?
Okay,
so before moving on, any questions about everything we've done until now? Don't worry too much if everything is a bit overwhelming. This is an info dump class. But as long as you remember to focus on who are the rivals, what are the issues, and how they get connected, you should be able to make sense of most of it. So I too will confess it can be very confusing with all the alliances and counter-alliances and everything. So, Louis' great attempt to resolve the issues that he wanted to dominate the western bank of the Rhine fails when in the east the Ottomans are defeated and in the west he is defeated. But in a way, it seems like maybe a balance of power will be created, a new concept that enters international relations. In which Louis will be the most powerful kingdom in Europe, but it will accept limits. Well, there is no peace, and the reason is this. The man everybody expected to die within a couple of years of becoming king of Spain finally dies 20 years later. Charles II, second of Spain, dies in 1700. Actually, he dies 40 years later, correction. Remember, this is the guy everybody thought is so deformed, so full of diseases, he'll die within 1 or 2 years and will solve everything. No, he was like, you guys want me dead. You know, some people, when you really wanted to do something and they hate you and they on purpose refuse to die, like sometimes your old grandmother or something. This was Charles. He was like, I'm gonna die, goddamn you all. Not to give you all the satisfaction. And he succeeded in surviving until 43 years, nobody expected. But he finally dies. Everybody room, hooray! But his death raises a question, which is, he didn't have any children. Who's going to be the new king of Spain? And since Spain does not have a Salic law, women cannot become king, so it has to be a man. There are two contenders here. On the one hand, the grandson of Louis the 14th, Philip. Philip is young, he's good looking, he's smart, he's active. And he's the person who Charles himself designates as his heir. Finally, the Spanish people, actually the Spanish aristocrats, really like Louis. They're sick and tired of the Habsburgs. They have country hate the Habsburgs. They want the Habsburgs gone. They say, you Habsburgs with your stupid wars over stupid Germany. Who cares? You destroyed our economy. You ruined us. We don't want you anymore. We want a Bourbon king. Yeah. See what the Bourbon did in France? They took a joke of a country, a failed state, and they made it the strongest state in Europe. So if we have a Bourbon, Spain will rise again. So we want a Bourbon. France got really pissed off by the violent attempts of William to kind of like overthrow him. So he said to King Louis XIV, your son shall be my heir. So that's a legitimate reason. But at the same time, Charles the Sixth, son of Leopold the First, Holy Roman Emperor, and Habsburg, also claims the throne by saying, well, the Habsburg dynasty in Spain, I am the legitimate heir to my uncle's kingdom. Salic law, okay? Family inheritance. I don't understand this aristocracy gets to choose. Spain is not an elected monarchy. This is important. I'm going to be looking, okay? Charles has the support of the English and the Dutch, who do not want to see Habsburg overthrown in Spain. Now,
Here's the thing. Until now, Louis has caused all the wars of Europe since he became king. In this era, he's now a middle-aged man. He's not anymore the young man who will drink and dance the ballet and go and fight wars. Now he's middle-aged, he's getting older, he's become artful, pious. God forgive me for all the men killed in my wars. He would like to resolve this peacefully. He goes and says, listen, let's agree to a partition. My son will take Spain and Naples, the European areas of and will give Flanders to the Habsburgs. And will also partition the colonies and everything. Who does not want? He's got his field of war. Unfortunately, the Spanish themselves are like, no! Either you get all of the Spanish inheritance, or we'll give it to a Habsburg, even if we hate them. So, they don't give him an option. If he wants his son, his grandson, Philip, to become king of Spain, he has to become king of all the Spanish territory. There is no option for partition anymore. Louis fears a united Habsburg Empire. He cannot permit Charles to become king of Spain and then emperor of the Habsburg Empire and the Holy Empire. But England and Austria fear that if a Bourbon rules France and a Bourbon rules Spain, what will happen? They unite, creating a great powerful hegemony which will be all the way from the Atlantic to the Rhine. Think about it. Spain and France united into one state. That's a very powerful state. Trust the Spanish colonies. The result of the whole Spanish succession. For the next 13 years, 14 years, Europe will once more become a colonial state. On the one side, France, and the other side, the fighting against a massive alliance again of Austria, the United Kingdom, the Dutch Republic, the Duke of Savoy in Italy, Portugal, and Catalonia. Catalonia has declared itself independent and has called Charles to become its king. So when you try to understand the current issues in Spain, you know, if you have been following the news about Catalan separatism, there was a referendum for independence and stuff like that. It goes back to this. It goes back to 200 years. In this war, Catalonia is fighting fully against the rest of Spain. This is a very long war. Initially, Louis again does well. He's better trained up in his more massive army, wins great victories. But the allies are lacking half with two stars of the military arts. Eugene of Savoy, who is originally from France, but was kicked out of France because of his family and became servant of the Austrian emperor and the Duke of Marlborough. The two of them together launched a brilliant campaign in which they decisively defeat the French armies and destroy any possibility of taking the Rhine. And then they invade France, but it turns out France able to go. Instead, the Bourbons are able to defeat the Allied armies and force the Habsburgs to barricade themselves in Barcelona, which is put under a very nasty siege. Such a nasty siege that if you go to Barcelona and you go to the old municipal building, there is a picture of Philip in the building that is upside down. They put his picture upside down out of hatred. Okay? And he also became allied invasions of France. So there's a stalemate. By the way, the Duke of Marlborough was the ancestor of Winston Churchill. Literally, Churchill was descended from the Duke of Marlborough. And he always thought of himself like my great son. took, you know, inspiration from each other. By the way, the beautiful hair you saw, that was on me. And guess who also introduced that kind of fashion into Europe? Louis the 14th. So high heels and beautiful boots. Where are the Swiss in this period? Now, Sweden is a great ally of France in the British period, okay, ever since the 30 Years' War. But Sweden is actually engrossed in another great northern war from 1779. Sweden, under the rule of Charles XII, one of the greatest warlord kings in the history of the human race, known in Turkey as Delika. Yeah, Delika is fighting by itself against Russia under Peter the Great, Augustus the Strong, who controls Saxony and Poland, and is called the Strong for two reasons. First of all, he fathered something like 102 children. He produced the biggest number of illegitimate children in the history of the world. Also, he was barely so strong that supposedly he could bend steel iron bars. A very strong guy. He also loved the weird, I'm going to trigger you all now, he also loved the weird sport of fox hunting. Back in that era, one of the favorite sports of the aristocracy was taking foxes, putting them on a lion sheet, and then tossing the sheet up and down until the foxes died. Yes, people were sick, despite all the nice clothes and everything. He used to be strong enough that he could do it with one hand and have like 20 men on the other hand. By the way, this was the entertainment for the ladies, not just for the men. Sometimes you prefer the crazy people who spend most of their time fighting wars. Peter is exhausted by this war and sues for peace in 1721 after Charles XII dies, is killed in a siege in Norway. Nobody more than 100% sure from where the shot that killed him came. Okay? Charles XII is also another big Sabbath of topics, so there's another heavy metal song for you. This time about Charles and his attitude towards life, which is very peculiar. Get the idea of how he talks about himself. What about the Ottomans? At the same time, it was happening 710. Delika is defeated at the Battle of Poltava by Peter the Great, but he's able to escape into the Ottoman Empire. He comes to the Ottoman Empire and he continuously intrigues, plus French gold, and everything. And the Ottomans are persuaded by him to go to war with Russia. From 1710 to 1711, the war actually is only fought for a year, but the negotiations last 3 years. In 1714, Russia loses the war. occupied in the East. By the way, during this period, the Li Kha is a guest of the Ottoman dynasty. At some point, the Janissaries get sick and tired of his continuous, let's do war, fight the Russian father. So they try to kill him. So I think Agyesilkoi, the cause of Agyesilkoi, 500 Janissaries arrived to try and kidnap him and arrest him. And here his 20 companions essentially are besieging the house, and they beat the 500 Janissaries away and escape. That was crazy. That didn't matter. Hardcore. You know, you don't want to fight this kind of a guy. So the result of all this warfare is the peace treaties of Utrecht, Basta, Vista. Okay? And these peace treaties bring to an end the conflicts initiated by Louis XIV. Does become the king of Spain. So he controls Spain itself, plus its South American colonies. On the other hand, Belgium, or Flanders, Naples, and all of the Italian dominions of Austria, of the Spain, go to the Austrian Habsburgs, now Charles VI, he becomes Emperor of Austria in the meantime. The British make massive colonial gains. This is the war. This is the war that makes Britain a great naval power. Until this war, France and the Dutch were more than able to beat the British in the sea. Indeed, France had one of the strongest navies. But because of this war, British were able to gain the upper hand and slowly build the Royal Navy that, as we're going to see, is going to dominate the world for the next 200 years and become the battle of the British Empire. And this is where the British Empire really starts. Yet now the colonies are not anymore small outposts in Africa and in Asia, but the large settler colonies in North America. Okay? Sweden, it is demographically destroyed, it is economically destroyed. Sweden in this year has the highest human loss in Europe. If I remember correctly from my statistics, something like 30% of the population dies because of this war. So the Swedish Empire, created by Gustavus Adolphus, the Swedish great power that had lasted for essentially 80 years, comes to an end. The Swedes lose the battle. The Basque Republic and modern Lithuania are also economically and demographically exhausted. This is the last time the Dutch Republic plays a central role as a great power in the history of Europe, and Ozyegin is starting to take the slow road to demographic, political, and economic disaster. The number of new European powers arise. Russia, until now considered a semi-barbaric Asiatic power, Peter the Great, and his new city and port, St. Petersburg, is able to project power into the Baltic, for the first time touches into the Black Sea. Slowly, slowly, the Russian Empire is becoming an active European polity. In Germany, the Elector of Brandenburg is able to win by his service a royal crown. King of Prussia. And he slowly is becoming the most important and powerful Protestant ruler in Germany. Finally, in Italy, the Duke of Savoy, historically a client of France, has now gained new territory and has been elevated from Duke to King. Let me remind you that the King of Savoy, King of Piedmont Savoy, is the kingdom that unites later on Italy to one kingdom of the universe. Why did this happen? Louis XIV dies and is replaced by a young child, Louis XV. So France needs peace in order to avoid a repetition of the succession wars that happened when Richelieu had died and when Louis was a king. So they need peace. England is most economically exhausted. When Queen Anne dies, she's succeeded by Germans, or German castles, the electors of Hanover. The current dynasty that rules England comes from Germany. They were the electors of Hanover. And they need peace, because if there's no peace, they are scared that France will support the Jacobites who are questioning the succession and make it hard for the Hanoverians to gain control of England. Finally, the Dutch, Spanish, or the Austrian Russians, they didn't want peace. They actually wanted to continue fighting. But here's the thing. A lot of them were there poor. If there is no English money, there's no French army to pay for their armies, they couldn't fight. They had to take the peace. So with the Treaty of Sedan, this is the capital of Europe in the West. Okay, slowly we're starting to see the Europe we know. Okay? Ottoman Empire loses Hungary. Okay? France has some territories, but still not able to reach the Rhine River. Okay? They wanted to get all of this. Naples becomes part of the dynasty, which has become the royal store. Rather than Russia becoming independent from Poland, and as we see, Russia is not going to the last thing. You can see the chaos in the borders of the East painted here. This is the border. You can see here how Russia is kept away from the sea. Okay? This is the border of the Swedish Empire. All of that territory was Russia. And St. Petersburg is founded by Peter the Great. Russia gains a part of Poland's control. Any questions? Any comments? You can read more about the Lee card. Might be interesting for you guys to learn about this part of Ottoman history. Thank you for participating in the class. Okay, everybody, I'll see you next week. Make sure to look at your activity rosters. I'll upload the PowerPoints are already uploaded online on LMS. I'm also going to upload a video on YouTube. I'll give you the channel place so you can do unboxing videos if you want to remember something. And don't worry if it's too confusing. I'm sure they were confused as well. Have a great day.